Praise the Hallelujah. Lord. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Praise the Lord. Praise him.
Yeah.
He's a great, 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 great God.
Glory, glory.
Let's praise him.
The Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great and greatly to be praised. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great. The name of the Lord is great.
Cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. The Lord who made heaven and earth. He said, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. He who keepeth thee, he will not slumber nor sleep. Upon thy right hand, oh.
from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, the Lord who made heaven and earth. He said, he will not suffer thy foot to be moved. Lord who keepeth thee, he shall not slumber nor sleep. For the Lord is my keeper, the Lord is my shade. Upon thy right hand, upon thy right hand. Oh, the sun shall not smite thee by day, nor the moon.
Say, my help comes from the Lord.
Yes, yes.
Thank God for friends and family, spouses, children, a church, a great church to belong to. But we must always remember that our help, my help, your help comes from the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah, saints of God. Let's have one more chorus of that. Can we have one more chorus of that?
My help.
My help.
Partakers of the inheritance, and part of the inheritance is the help of the Lord. When you get saved, you get the help of God. Hallelujah. And he is a big help. Well, I want to welcome you to tonight's service. Those of you all who are here and those of you all who are online, we welcome you in the mighty name of Jesus. We thank God for your tuning in tonight. If you're tuning in for the first time, would you text WELCOME to 773-378-9253. And we would be more than happy to have heard that you've tuned in, and we love to connect with you and have you come and worship with us and be blessed in Jesus' name. Well, just by way of announcement, next Sunday is Pastor's Appreciation. Praise the Lord. You want to come up and just share a little bit? Minister Diane. All right.
Thank you. Thanks. Hello, Pastor Eric and Karen. We just want to celebrate you and let you guys know how much we appreciate you.
I appreciate you guys for making the welcoming environment and joining the church. I want to thank you guys for being a good, godly example both in and out of church.
I want to appreciate you for a great leadership.
I appreciate you guys for all the godly mentors in my life.
I just want to thank you guys for all the wisdom y'all have given me over all these years.
I appreciate you guys for always being there for me.
And on behalf of Living Proof, we just want to say, Pastor,
we love you!
Amen! Isn't that wonderful? Oh, it brings tears to my eyes. Oh, that was wonderful, Living Proof, Brother Craig. Just a reminder, you know what day it is? Sunday, our Pastor Appreciation Day. Amen? Amen, amen. We look forward to a wonderful day, and that God will come in and bless us and bless our pastors, and the word will go out, and we would just have a phenomenal day. So I look forward to seeing each and every one of you here on Sunday. Amen.
Thank you, Minister Diane. Love to have all you all come out and celebrate with us. Pastor's Appreciation. Then Sunday, May the 12th, is another special day, Mother's Day. Praise the Lord. We want to honor and encourage the mothers for their hard work and lift them up in the Word of God. And we've been asking, I've been going around asking people to take seven cards, seven stamps, and seven smaller flyers and send them out to all your friends and what have you. And let's pack out the house. This is one way to compel them to come. Jesus said in Luke 14:23, go out into the highways and byways and compel them. This is one way to compel them to come. Now, I went to some people and they said, well, I don't have any addresses. How about the address next door to your house? That's an address. You can go outside and look at it and say, oh, I'm going to invite my neighbor. I don't think I'd be pastoring today if it wasn't for a lady by the name of Mrs. Donahue who stepped outside her house, went two doors down, and told my mother about Jesus. And here I am, a pastor today. And she's still alive. That was over 55 years ago. She's still alive. And I thank God for Ms. Donahue. Every day I thank God. Every time I think about her, I thank God for her coming outside of her Christianity, her comfort zone, going two doors down and telling my mother about Jesus, who later told me about Jesus, and I got saved. So let's pack out God's house, Mother's Day. We're looking forward to a better attendance than Resurrection Sunday. Standing room only. How many people believe we can do it? We're in revival. Our church is in revival. Now, for people who come, and it's Mother's Day for us too, but it's revival. This church is in revival, okay? The Lord added to the church such as should be saved. And we've been hearing about miracles. And who was that who came up and said her back? Barbara. But, you know, two more people came to me and said, you know, Pastor, when the message was going forward, I was having an aching pain in my back, and it all left. Hello, somebody. You know, God does his biggest miracles when there's an expectation in the atmosphere. When a lot of people are here, God can do things, wonderful things. One time Jesus turned away from a city because they weren't prepared to receive him. Okay, we're going to do our part, prepare to receive the Lord and all that he is, all his miracles, signs, and wonders. Again, Mother's Day. There's lots of mothers out there need to hear a good word of encouragement. God will do the saving. God will do the encouraging. But we have to do our part. That's inviting. And so I want to hand out this to everyone and ask you to do your very best to reach outside of yourself and invite someone. Jesus said, go out to the highways and byways and compel them to come. All right. Well, we're looking forward to a great day. And my wife's going to have a powerful word. It's going to bless all the mothers that come. And Brother Johnny, he's going to be cooking all by himself Mother's Day. We have a Mother's Day. No, I'm just kidding. The men are going to be sweating and working on Mother's Day because we're going to cook up a storm. They are, not me. They're going to cook up a storm. Johnny and the crew of men going to be cooking breakfast for Mother's Day. So the people you invite, you can say, you can come out and have breakfast too. Oh, my God, let God use you. Amen? All right. Well, thank God for Brother Johnny. He did it last year, and it was wonderful, and I know it's going to be wonderful this year as well. That's all on May the 12th, Mother's Day. Praise the Lord. We do the our part, and God will do the heavy lifting. Then we have prayer going on throughout the week, every Tuesday at 6:30 to 7:30. Grief Share meets every Tuesday at 7. We have a baptism, water baptism, on the fourth Sunday this month. Okay, want to pray for Mother Brown, who lost her grandchild, I believe it was. So let's keep her up in prayer. And I believe the funeral, they'll have the more information. I believe the homegoing service funeral is Monday. So let's keep Sister Brown up in prayer. Amen. Then we have bookstores and got a lot of good books and things like that. If you don't read the book, well, buy a book for someone else as a gift and be a blessing that way as well. Well, I'm up here to take up our Sunday morning tithes and offerings. Let's also keep, not Sunday morning, Wednesday. What am I thinking? Wednesday. Everybody say Wednesday. It's Wednesday, Pastor. It's Wednesday, not Sunday. Wednesday. Let's keep Evangelist Charlie Parrish up in prayer as well. He needs some healing as well. And we love him. We miss him. But let's just keep him up in prayer. Okay, praise God. Well, our offertory scripture is found in Malachi chapter 3, chapter 10. Bring all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house, and prove me now herewith, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open up for you the windows of heaven and pour you out such a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it. God is so good. He blesses us, and he wants us to take a portion of that blessing and honor him with it. And what he does, he takes it and blesses us back with it. A lot of things in our lives that we don't even know we need, but God knows. He's our Heavenly Father, and he'll honor you if you honor him with the tithes, and we use the tithes for the furtherance of the gospel. We use the tithes and offering to get more people saved. Everybody say more people saved. That's right. We don't want to just be satisfied and with just a few, us four, no more. No, we want to see more people saved because God says in his word, he's not willing that any should perish, but that all come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Well, it does take finances to do that. It took finances for Jesus' ministry. He had a treasurer, Judas, and it takes money to further the gospel. We thank God for your faithful financial support, your sacrifices, and the hard work you do in terms of supporting your church. And our prayer is that God will bless you a hundredfold and some. Amen? Let's bow our heads in prayer. Well, let's stretch our hands toward the offering basket, just as they did back when Jesus took the few loaves of bread and a few fish and multiplied and fed 5,000 men plus women and children. He first gave thanks. He took the few loaves and few fish and lifted it up to the Father and gave thanks. We thank you, Lord. You've given us good jobs and houses to live in. None of us are sleeping under a bridge. None of us are living in a halfway house or a shelter. Lord, you've been good to us. Let us not ever forget how good you've been to us and how you want us to be vessels, conduits that others might get blessed. Father, we thank you, we praise you for this opportunity to worship you in this way. We ask for a hundredfold return on our giving. Father, we thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Bless every tither, every giver in Jesus' name, and every believer said, amen. Okay, we're going to have one more song of praise and worship. Then Brother Tarnell is going to come up and give us a rich word tonight.
Praise the Lord. How many of you are expecting God to move tonight?
Yes.
Amen. We're expecting.
respect him.
You are about to experience a life-changing moment. You won't be the same way you came, 'cause he's in our very midst. You will be healed, delivered. He's here to set you free. And because God is here, anything can happen in here, in here, in here. Anything can happen in here, in here, in here.
You are about to experience a life-changing moment. Same way you came, 'cause he's in our very midst. You will be healed, delivered. Jesus is here to set you free. And because God is here,
anything can happen in here, in here.
Something good,
something good,
oh, yeah.
Something good.
Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Your breakthrough is in your praise. Amen. Your breakthrough is in your praise. When you praise the Lord, The Bible says he inhabits the praises of his people. God, thank you, Jesus. Oh, bless your name, Lord God. Bless your name, Jesus. Oh, God, thank you, Jesus. Oh, have your way, Lord. Have your way, Jesus. Get breakthroughs tonight, Father. Oh, God, you are our provider. You are the self-existing one. You are the all-sufficient one, Lord God. There is nothing impossible with him with whom we have to do. Ah, whatever it is, whatever is weighing you down, he said, cast it on me, for I care it for you. God cares for you. God cares for you. Hallelujah. Don't keep walking around with these heavy loads. Give it to the Lord. Give it to the Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. There is deliverance. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Ah, praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for this night, Lord God. But most of all, we thank you for your presence, Lord. God, if you're not here, Lord God, what's the purpose? We're here, Lord, to lift up the name of Jesus, to glorify you, Lord God. We came to magnify you, Lord God, for your name is great. Thank you, Lord God. Strengthen me and my body, Lord God. Let your spirit energize my spirit, Lord God. Bring to my remembrance your word, Lord God. Help me to glorify you this night, Lord God. As I step back, Lord God, you step up. Show yourself strong tonight, Lord God. Speak through this vessel, Lord God. You know the needs of your people, Lord God. Everyone that's seated here today, Lord God, you knew that they would be here this night. And Lord God, you came to meet their needs, Lord God. They trust you, Lord God. They trust you, Lord God. They have given things to you, Lord God, and they are waiting, Lord God, for you to answer these prayers, Lord God, to meet these needs. God, show yourself strong. Show yourself strong, Father, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I got about 10 pages of notes. So we're going to be here for about 2 hours. Is that all right? Amen. Praise God. As you know, we have been in a study concerning the names of God. Amen. The names of God. Pastor Karen spoke about 5 names. Amen. Starting with Elohim, Jehovah, El Shaddai, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Makedesh. Amen. And all of these names meet certain needs that people have in their lives. Can you guys hear me? I know I'm talking a little soft. Amen. All of these names represent some character of God. And it behooves you and I to get to know God in such an intimate way. Amen. Because the more and better you get to know God, the more peace you're going to have, the more trust you're going to have in Him. Because God is a God who does not change. Amen. Once you trust Him, you can always trust Him.
Hallelujah.
He don't lie. Amen. He provides. Amen. And he sets us apart, right? Last time I was here, we talked about Jehovah Makedesh, right? And Jehovah Makedesh means what? The Lord, my sanctifier. Amen. He comes to sanctify you and you and you. Even though he will sanctify the whole group, God deals with individuals too. Amen. And he wants to be your sanctifier. So don't stop God from doing what he wants to do in your life. Amen. We have another name that we're going to talk about. Amen. And this name is Jehovah Nissi. Jehovah Nissi. Now, Jehovah Nissi means the Lord my banner. Amen. The Lord my banner. We talked about what's in the name. It's a lot in the name. People always want to make a name for themselves, don't they? Amen. Names are synonymous with certain people and certain things. At the Tower of Babel, these guys got together, and you know what they said? They said, we want to make a name for ourselves. Yeah. They weren't talking about making a name for God. They want to make a name for themselves. And the sad thing about that is a lot of people in the world want to make a name for themselves. And you know what they do? They get their reward because they're not glorifying God. They get their reward from all the accolades that people give them. Okay? And names can be famous or infamous. You know some infamous people? Infamous people are people who have done dastardly deeds. What do you look at? When you think of Ted Bundy, what comes to mind? Serial killer. Oh, that's... Would you want to be known for as a serial killer?
No.
Amen. Nah. When you think about Adolf Hitler, what comes to mind? Mass murderer. Amen. He was infamous. These people were infamous. People throughout the ages have always wanted to make names for themselves, okay? And I don't want to get into all that right now, but the Bible says a lot about God and his name, okay? David said a lot of things. In Psalms 34, verse 3 and 5, it says, oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name. Together. Amen. Together. Magnify the Lord and exalt his name. Proverbs 18:10 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it. And they are saved. Amen. Not the wicked. The wicked can forget it. This is a place reserved only for the righteous. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. Have you ever called on the name of the Lord and got delivered and had needs met?
Yes.
Amen. Because the name of the Lord is a strong tower.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord will keep you safe. Amen. Psalms 113, blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and from evermore, or from eternity to eternity.
Yes.
Blessed be the name of the Lord from eternity to eternity. O Lord, our Lord, Psalms 81. How majestic is your name in all the earth. How beautiful, how wonderful, how powerful, how greatly to be admired is your name. The world don't know the Lord like we do. They are not going to exalt the name of the Lord. They are not going to magnify the name of the Lord. That's why the Lord sanctified you and me, that we might be set apart to do these things, to glorify him in the earth and to lift up his name and to make him known. That is what we are supposed to, that's our Father's business. And we are supposed to be about our Father's business, just like Jesus said, I must be about my Father's business. Amen. Are you about your Father's business? When you go to work, do you lift up the name of the Lord or do you keep quiet? Somebody on your job come there with a, my headache, I got a headache. Do you say, let me pray for you? Or do you say, well, I got aspirin? Or do you say first? Aspirin, huh? Amen. It says, ascribe to the Lord the glory due to his name and give the Lord credit and glory that he is due. Holy and awesome is his name. David said, unite my heart to fear your name. Give me an undivided heart. How many of us have an undivided heart? How many of us does God have the preeminence in our lives? Or do we spend too much time with other things other than the Lord? The Lord don't come first. Everything else comes first. That's a divided heart. But God wants your heart. Amen. He wants your heart undivided. He wants your, my wife always say, when she wants to talk to me, see, I need your undivided attention. Because I will turn this. Don't walk. Just stand still and listen to what I got to say. Give me your undivided attention. Sometimes I got ADHD, I guess, but I can't sit still when she's talking, okay? But she said, God wants our undivided attention as well. Amen. He wants our undivided. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. In this earthen vessel, your kingdom come, your will be done in here. Amen. Praise God. Throughout history, like I say, men have always wanted to make a reputation for themselves. And a lot of them have. When we think of the Albert Einstein, what do we think about? His inventions, with the light bulb and all this stuff, okay? Edison, my mind is racing right now. My mind is going 100 miles an hour, y'all. Today, Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner. We all know what banners are because we got banners around here, don't we? Building bridges to establish relationships to advance Christ's kingdom. That's a banner. Amen? Building bridges to establish relationships to advance Christ's kingdom. We got another banner back there, right? A banner is a rallying point, okay? A banner is a statue. A banner is what draws people together. Okay. When we think about the banner in the Old Testament, because Jehovah Nissi first appeared in the Old Testament in the book of Exodus. Okay. And we're going to get into this story a little bit, but remember Moses had a rod. Remember the rod that Moses carried around? What did that rod represent? A banner. He didn't have no big old sheet spread out with words printed all on it. But that banner represented something. It represented the presence of God, and it represented the power of God. Okay? Now, this banner was around when? When Moses became a shepherd, he began to carry a stick to take care of the sheep, right? But God used that stick, and it became a rallying point, okay? And Moses did what God told him to do, and they were delivering the people of Israel, okay? Now, let's look at Israel for 1 minute, okay? Now, these people have been in bondage for what? 400 years or more. Now, in those 400 years, a lot of things happened. Generations went by, didn't it? And a lot of people forgot about God because they was under harsh taskmasters. They were being treated cruelly. Have you ever been treated cruelly? Not because you had a whooping. That ain't cruel. That was probably do you. Amen. But they was under this taskmaster for 400 years, and they had gotten away from their God. They had gotten away from this intimacy with their God. Okay? But God hadn't forgotten about them because God had a covenant with them, right? Along comes Moses. God sends him. And he said, go and tell Pharaoh to let my people go. Pharaoh said, I don't know the Lord. I ain't going to let your people go. We gonna even have to hash this out. Okay? But God did something. And God did what he did because he was reestablishing his relationship with his people. He wanted them to come back into the place where we can trust you, God. We can trust you, God. Trust is not an easy thing once it's lost. And they lost their trust in God because they had been praying, and their kids done died, and they're still praying. Grandchildren come along, they praying, and generations have gone by. So they are holding God with spite in their heart. God, why you let this happen to us? Anything ever happened to you that you thought was unfair? That God should have did something. God, why you let this happen to me? You know what you need? You need a visitation from Jehovah Nissi. That's what you need. Excuse me. So here we are, Israel. God is reestablishing his relationship with him. And guess what? Listen. Forward, they are on their way out of Egypt, okay? And they're being led by Moses. This is a ragtag bunch of people, right? They are not warriors, they are just slaves. And in slavery, the Egyptians did not train them to be warriors, did they? They trained them to make bricks. That's what you do. Your job is to make bricks. Now, they are set free. They are on their way out. They get to the Red Sea, and lo and behold, they are boxed in, and Pharaoh is coming behind them. But what else is behind them? God is behind them, right? God said, I got your back. And here's God in with this swirling cloud by day, by night, and this swirling fire by night. Why? Because he's trying to instill in them, hey, trust me. Hallelujah. Trust me. Okay? But there's always a naysayer in the crowd. There's always somebody that's saying, Moses, you brought us out here. We could have stayed in Egypt. Dathan. And Moses finally stood up and said, be quiet, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord. So he said, Moses, stretch out that rod you got in your hand. Stretch out your banner. Moses stretched out the banner and the power of God began to move, a strong east wind blow, and it parted the sea and it went across on dry land, right? God just showed up, amen, as a who? A deliverer, a protector. He showed up, okay? They go across, they get across, and they look back, and Pharaoh is coming to the idiot. I would never have ventured into that water. He didn't open it up for you. He opened it up for them. And he going to get himself in this little predicament. Ain't no way out. So once the water comes back, all of them drown. And the people of Israel, they get to the other side, and what do they do? What do they do when they get to the other side? They was praising God like mad. They was over there, Miriam, and she had a tambourine, and they were just singing the songs of Moses. And boy, they was getting down. They was getting down. God was reestablishing relationship and trust with these people. So guess what? Okay, Moses said, we didn't dance enough. It's time for us to get to moving. They started moving through the wilderness. I ain't gonna pick on nobody. Okay, let me ask this question out. Now, you guys say God has done something good in your life, right? Done something fantastic and marvelous in your life, right? How did it make you feel when God did what he did for you? Who wanted to volunteer? How did it make you feel? It made you feel great, okay? Yeah, it did what for you? It made you what? Trust God and love God more, didn't it? Let me ask you this. How long did that feeling last? How long did that feeling last? Pastor Ken said hers lasted a long time. How long did yours last? Amen. It should last a long time. But guess what? Here, Israel, they have come through the Red Sea. You thought that would have been enough, right? That would have been enough for me for a while, I guess. But guess what? They began walking through this wilderness 3 days later. 3 days after they parted, come through this Red Sea, they are complaining. And Moses, what in the world have you done to us? You have brought us out here to die. Now, what idiot would think that? Why would God deliver you, part the Red Sea, to let you die on the other side? So they are complaining, Moses, we need water. So what did Moses do? They come to a place called Marah. And when they get to Marah, there's water there. And now when you're thirsty, what's the first thing you do? You fall down at that figure. You just and they spitting all this water out because this water is what? This water is bitter. And Moses, they crying out, what about the Lord? Why come they don't call on God? But they relying on Moses instead of relying on God. See? So guess what they do? God tell Moses, go and cut this tree down. Throw it in the water, okay? Moses cut the tree down, threw it in the water, and miraculously this water turned sweet. And everybody had water to drink. What they doing now? Thank you, Lord. God, I'm sorry. Forgive me for complaining. That's what they did. So guess what? They went probably maybe a day's journey or so, and they came to a place called Elim. We all know about Elim, don't we? Elim represents what? What was in Elim? Place of rest. But what did they find in Elim? 12 wells and 70 palm trees. Now, those numbers are significant, right? The 12 represents what? The 12 tribes. The 70 represent what? The number of people that went into Egypt at the beginning, right? Joseph and his brothers and all that bunch. It was 70 of them that went into Egypt. How many came out? 2 million at least. God was giving them a sign. Y'all, listen, I know who you are. You are my people. Okay, I made a covenant with you guys. I have engraved you on the palms of my hand. Can a mother forget her suckling child? Well, God said, I won't forget you either. He said, you are mine. I have sanctified you. I am Jehovah Makedesh to you. I sanctified, I set you apart, okay, for a purpose. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm not going to leave you. You are mine. You need to trust me. Guess what? They stayed at Elim for a while, just like we did. Amen. We stayed in Elim for a while, and we got rested up. Amen. We enjoyed the blessings of God and all. You would now. They, I'm pretty sure they filled up all their water bottles because they going through a desert, right? And ain't no water in the desert that they crossing. So they packed up water. Day 15 after leaving the Red Sea situation. Day 12 after Marah, they did what? Moses! They need what? Ain't no water. We need some more water, Moses. And not only do we need water, we just ate up all the food too. So what did God do? God rained manna down from heaven. And manna is what? What's it? Ain't no name for it. It's called the what's it. Whatever it is, we eating it. They call it angel food, but manna needs, amen, whole food. Amen. But God is building up this relationship with these people so they know that we can trust God. When we are in situations, when we are lacking, he is Jehovah Jireh. He's our provider. He has provided water. He has provided manna. If we go on, you're going to see that he provided other stuff for him as well. But let's look at Jehovah Nissi. Now he's coming on the scene, okay? In Exodus, if you want to turn to Exodus chapter 17, okay? We're just going to look at that for a little bit. Yep, and these people in 17:1, it says, and all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin, it's not Sin, it's Sin, after their journeys according to the commandment of the Lord and pitched in Rephidim. And there was no water for the people to drink. Here we go again. They already forgot that God supplied water, didn't they? I guess they figure, well, God, I know you did it once. I know you're getting tired of supplying us with water. Why would he get tired of supplying you with water? He brought you this way where he knew there was no water. So evidently, he intended to supply your needs. And a lot of times we forget just because, you know, we're going through a thing, a test or a trial in our life, we forget about God. And we want to do this thing. What can I do? How can I fix this situation? And a lot of times we want to take matters into our own hands. But they complained to Moses, and then Moses, God told Moses, okay, I want you to, I'm going to stand on a rock. When you see me, Moses, I want you to strike that rock, okay? And water is going to come forth. So the presence of the Lord was there, probably in that cloud. Something was there. And Moses struck the rock, and water began to gush from that rock. And we all know that this rock is who? Jesus. How we know this? Because the word tells us there was Jesus. If you go to the New Testament of Hebrews, and that rock that followed them was Jesus. Okay? So Jesus was their rock that supplied water. Okay? So here they go. They are complaining. God give them water again. And you know what they did in verse 7? And they called the name of the place, and Moses called the name of the place Massah and Meribah, because of the chiding, the complaining, the contention of the children of Israel, and because they tempted the Lord, saying, the Lord is the Lord with us. Is the Lord for us? Is the Lord on our side? How in the world can they let these words come out of their mouth? After all that God has done for them, they go have the audacity, the nerve to ask this question, is the Lord with us? And but you know what they were saying? We don't want no part-time God. God, we want you here so we can see you every day. That's what they asked me. Lord, we don't want you here just every now and then. God, we want you here. We want to be able to see you. We'll trust you if we can see you. Who had that problem? Who had that problem? Who? Doubting Thomas, right? He said, I ain't going to believe unless I can see something. There's a lot of people out there now. They got to see something first before they believe it. But the Bible said we walk by faith and not by sight. So they asked the question, is the Lord among us? Is he with us? And right after that, Teresa, doctor, minister, can you read that for me? Starting at verse 8.
Now Amalek came and fought with Israel.
Oh, stop right there. Who came and fought against Israel? Amalek. Now, who is Amalek? Who is Amalek? Mr. Makiba, who is Amalek? I know. Relatives of Israel, because they are descendants of who? Jacob's brother Esau. So these folk are cousins. But Amalek has a problem with Israel. Why? Why would you think Amalek would have a problem with Israel? Evidently, their father put something in them. Because, yeah, I got a problem with your uncle Jacob. He stole my birthright, and I ain't going to never forgive him for that. Is there people in your family that's like that? They holding grudges against you, and they don't want to forgive you because of some, I guess he didn't look at this as a trivial thing. Losing the birthright wasn't a trivial thing to him, okay? So he passed this thing down and he poisoned the minds of his children, his grandchildren, his great-grand, all the way down. And now they are a wild bunch. This is a wild bunch, these Amaleks, okay? They are fighters. And here you got Israel coming through the wilderness. They then went through the desert. And now they still are warriors. They're not warriors. They're not fighters. But Amalek comes along, and the Bible says, Amalek fought with Israel in Rephidim. Now we're going to see. What is God going to do now? My God, you got a bunch right here that can't even defend themselves. But what did God say? God said, if I be what? If I be for you, I'm more than the world against you. God said, if I be for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. We need to get that down in our spirit. God is on our side. So here we go. They fought against Israel at Rephidim. And Moses, I'm sorry, verse 9.
And Moses said to Joshua, choose us some men and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in my hand. So Joshua did as Moses said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And so it was, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let his down his hand, Amalek prevailed.
Stop for a minute. Moses is up on the hill. Joshua and the children of Israel are down in the valley fighting Amalek. The Bible said Moses raised up his hands. What does this look like? Worship, praise. It looked like surrender too, but they wasn't surrendering. It looks like praise, okay? And that's what it represented. Moses had the rod of God in his hand, and the significance of this is his hands is raised, and it is what? Calling on heaven for help. God, help us in this situation. And as long as that rod was up, God was helping. But guess what? Have you ever held your hand up so long and you're working overhead and your arms get tired? And you're like, oh, shoot, my arms are tired. I'm starting to get a cramp. Huh? Well, Moses' arm got tired. Moses let down his hand and he let down that rod, which represented intercession, okay, on behalf of God. God, we are interceding on you for help. Okay, God, we got this. When Moses let down his hands, Amalek began to prevail in the battle. So Moses mustered up enough strength, and he raised his hand up again, and the battle turned in favor of Israel. But Moses' hands got tired again, and he let his arms down, and Amalek began to prevail again. Well, we had two people standing next to Moses who had some discerning. And who are these two people? Aaron and Hur. And they noticed something. They noticed that when Moses had his hands up, we were winning. When Moses let his hands down, we're losing. We need to help Moses. Hallelujah. So they came along and they held Moses' hands up. We all go through battles, don't we? We all have circumstances and situations in our lives, and sometimes we just get tired of fighting. What do you need when you get tired of fighting and you think you're going it alone? What do you need? You need support, don't you? You need help. There ought to be people in your life that you can call alongside to hold you up. They don't have to hold your hands up. They have to lift you up in prayer. They need to be interceding for you. The Bible said, bear ye one another's burdens. There are some things that we need help with our crazy kids, our grandbabies, our wayward husbands, wayward wives, crazy bosses and crazy people that you work with. There are some, we need help with some of these situations. You need to, there ought to be people in your life that you can trust to come alongside you in prayer and say, can you pray with me about this situation? That's what we need. And when they do, you should feel some relief. Amen. Yes. When they intercede on your behalf toward heaven, who are they calling on? They are calling on Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner, the Lord our victor, the Lord who protects, the Lord who is our standard. We calling on you for help, Lord. We need your help.
Hallelujah.
So guess what? They held Moses' hands up until Joshua won the battle. Now, something else happens here. God says something right here. Read 13 and 14 for me, and 15 and 16. Start with 13.
So when Joshua defeated Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword, then the Lord said to Moses, write this for a memorial in the book and recount it in the hearing of Joshua, that I will utterly blot out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called its name Jehovah Nissi, the Lord is my banner. For he said, because the Lord has sworn, the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation.
Okay. This battle, while it was going on, there was a part I wanted to. They was holding Moses' arms up, okay? So, and they went and got a stone, okay? And this stone was for Moses to sit on. Now, this just wasn't some arbitrary stone. This stone has some type of representation to it, as far as I'm concerned. This is just my opinion, okay? But what does Moses represent? Moses represents the law, right? Moses represents the law, if we fast forward, okay? The rock that Moses is sitting on and monitored, I'm just in my interpretation, represents Jesus, okay? Moses, the Bible said there is a rest for the people of God, and that rest is found in Jesus Christ. The law rest took a rest when Jesus came on the scene and fulfilled the law for you and I. Now you have a rest. What are you resting from? Hey, man, that's another whole new thing we got to talk about there. Okay? But he said, I want you to, Joshua, God told me to remind you about what went down today. Remember Amalek. Remember Amalek. Because God says, I am going to do what? I am going to what? Utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. Was God playing? No. That sounds kind of harsh, don't it? Man, God gonna kill Amalek? Why is God gonna kill these people? Well, if you move on up into the book of Deuteronomy 25, this comes up again, and he says, Joshua, I remember what Amalek did. He said, don't you forget it. I want you to continue to rehearse this. And not only was they rehearsing it to Joshua, but they were rehearsing it to who? All the people and the children of Israel was hearing this story. They're hearing what God said that he's going to do with Amalek. Well, God got them. Is he kind of senile and he forgets stuff? No. 420 years later, in the book of Samuel, God said, I remember what Amalek did, and now it is payday. So Saul is the king. He says, Saul, what did he tell Saul? He says, Saul, I want you to do what? I want you to utterly, that's what he said right here, I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. He says, Saul, I want you to go and I want you to utterly destroy Amalek. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, every cow, every sheep, every donkey, everything that Amalek owns, I want you to destroy it. Boy, God is what? The Bible says it is a terrible thing to fall into the hands of the living God. God don't forget nothing. People forget. But God don't forget. He's long-suffering, sometimes too long for me sometimes. God, get him now, God. Don't wait. Get him, God. Y'all have done that before, too, so don't look at me all funny, please. Okay, but Saul has a task. now. What does Saul do? Well, Samuel the prophet already told him, you know, this is what God wants you to do. So Saul didn't do what God told him to do and utterly destroy Amalek. Samuel the prophet comes along and he hear all these sheep bleeding and he hear all these mooing of the cows and he say, what is this? And there's the king Agag of the Amalek is sitting right there with Saul. Samuel say, what is this? What did God tell you to do? He said, well, it wasn't my fault. The people wanted to do this. Who should you listen to, the people or God? We should listen to God, not people. So Saul killed Agag, okay? Agag represents our flesh, okay? And what do? Our flesh battles with us all the time, don't it? And it's going to be battling with us until we leave here. I don't care how sanctified you call yourself. I don't care how holy you think you are. Your flesh is going to act up. You're going to say something. You're going to look at somebody with a pop in your neck and, can't stand her. And God knows all this stuff. And you might be smiling while you're saying it. But God knows what's in here. So Amalek represents the flesh. And God wants to crucify this flesh. That's why he said, utterly destroy Amalek. Destroy this flesh. Don't make no provisions for your flesh. Because if you don't destroy the flesh, what's going to happen? It's going to keep on rearing its head up. It's going to keep on at the most inopportune time. Your flesh is going to rise up and embarrass you. So guess what happened? Some of Amalek got away. We fast forward and we go all the way up to Esther. In the book of Esther, we run into who? Haman. And who is Haman? The Bible says Haman the Agagite. What? Haman the who? The Agagite. That means he is a descendant of who? King Agag of the Amalek bunch that Saul was supposed to utterly destroy. Now, they got to deal with this because guess what his descendants did? And they said, we're going to write this in the book, what Israel did. They tried to wipe us out, but they didn't do it. We're going to pay them back one day. Generations later, down the line, Haman is number two in the kingdom of Persia. And he has a problem with Mordecai, the Jew. And now he said, I don't want to just kill Mordecai. I want to kill every Jew in the province, every man, every woman, every boy, and every girl. Why? Revenge. Because he's been told by his people, remember what Israel did. But guess what? Jehovah Nissi comes on the scene in the book of Esther, even though his name isn't mentioned. Because now he rises up again. Because what do? They lift them hands up. They lift them hands up and they begin to call on the name of the Lord. And the Lord steps in because the Lord remember his promise to utterly destroy the remembrance of Amalek off the earth. Amen. God don't forget. If God promised you something, you can take that to the bank. God is true to his word. He don't lie. If you got a promise from God, and the book is full of them, if you read the book, you'll find out what kind of promises God has for you.
And then you stand on that. You stand on God's word. Yeah. Don't stand on my word. Don't stand on Pastor Eric's word. Don't stand on my wife's word or any of these ministers. Don't stand on their word. Stand on the word of God. Right. Read it for yourself. Get the promise for yourself. Amen. Amen. Now you got something to stand on. God, you said in your word, and you present that to God. Amen. And you trust God. Even when it seems like you're going through a desert place, trust God, because he is Jehovah Jireh. He's going to provide. Amen. He has a plan and a purpose for your life. So you are. We all have battles. Pastor Eric always said, right? You either in a battle, you going through a battle, or you're coming out of a battle. We all have battles, don't we? Amen. But God is on our side, and God is going to bring us through. Just trust what he says, okay? And the last thing I want to mention, God's name. I say, everybody want to make a name for themselves. They have broken all kind of records. Mark McGwire, all-time home run baseball hitter, okay? Everybody know Mark McGwire, if y'all keep up with baseball. He got more home runs than Babe Ruth. He got more home runs than Roger Maris. He got more home runs than Henry Aaron. He got more home runs than Sammy Sosa. He's number one all-time home run hitter, Mark McGwire, okay? But guess what? All these people who have made a name for themselves cannot trump what God has done. You can't trump what God has done. God created the world, and ain't nobody been able to break that record. That's right. Nobody. And ain't nobody gonna break that record, because nobody else has the power to create what God created just by saying, let there be. Can anybody do that? Amen. You cannot trump God. Only God can do that. God is the only one who is holy. God is holy. He makes you holy of yourself. You unholy. You unrighteous. But God invested something in you that made you holy, which was his Holy Spirit. Now you take on that divine nature. You have that holy nature within you. Amen. Could nobody give you that but God? And God did it through his son, Jesus Christ. Amen. So, that banner, that rod that Moses held up represented the presence of God for a while. But then along came something else that took the place of the rod, which was the covenant took the place of the rod, because the rod went into the ark, the presence of God. That ark represented the presence of God. And when they walked, put their foot in the water, what happened? The waters parted. When they went out to battle, they carried that ark, because they had Jehovah Nissi with them in the presence of that ark. Okay? Amen. So, where's your rod? Do you have a rod that you can hold up? You don't need no stick. You got two rods right here. Hold them up. Amen. You hold these up and you just, Lord, thank you for being my Jehovah Nissi. Amen. God, thank you for being my protector, my banner, my victory. God will give us victory. All we have to do is keep them hands up. Yes. Don't get tired. If you get tired, call somebody else to hold them hands up for you. Hold them hands up with you. Amen? And let them pray while you sleepy and tired. Amen. Let somebody else intercede. God will answer prayer. And the thing about this is, he don't lie, right? He answers prayer, not when we want it all the time, But in his time, God answers prayer. All we got to do is trust the Lord. Amen. How many of you guys trust the Lord today? Amen. We trusted him enough to give him our lives, didn't we? Yes. Amen. Are you saved today? If you are saved today, that means you trusted God, because you won't get saved without trusting him.
Amen.
Jehovah Nissi, the Lord our banner, the Lord our victor, the Lord our statue. Okay? Today, we have another banner. And what's that other banner we have? The Word of God.
Hallelujah.
The Word of God is the banner. Amen. And the Word of God is Rhema, and it is Logo. It is alive and it is written. Amen. But it's our banner. We can stand on this word because this word is God. God is his word, and his word is him. God is his name, and his name is him. You can't separate the two. You can't separate God from the word, and you can't separate the word from God. You can't take God's name away from him and he ceased to be that thing. We ain't going to call him Jehovah Nissi no more. That don't mean he ain't Jehovah Nissi. Uh-huh. Amen. You can stop calling him Jehovah Jireh. That don't mean he ain't Jehovah Jireh. He's still going to be what he is.
Amen.
So don't ever give up on the God that we serve. Amen. Amen. He loves us. And he loved us first. Amen. He loved us first. So today, amen, let's keep our trust and our confidence in the God of our salvation. Amen. Let's bow for a word of prayer. Amen. Father, we thank you, Lord God. We thank you for who you are. You are Jehovah. Hallelujah. You are El Shaddai. You are Elohim. You are Jehovah Rapha. Amen. You are Jehovah Makedesh. You are Jehovah Nissi. God, you are all these things, Lord God, and more. You are all that in a bag of chips, God. Ain't nobody like our God. So, God, today, Lord God, we're not going to ask the question like Israel did. Is God with us? We know you're with us, Lord. Your word tells us that you ain't gonna never leave us nor forsake us. So, Lord God, we stand on your word. And we thank you for that, Lord God. Oh, God, we will not be fearful. We will not fret, Lord God, or what things may look like, Lord God, because you said you have not given us a spirit of fear. All we got to do is trust you, Lord. You said, peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, give I unto you. You said, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. So, Father, have your way. I pray that you meet your people where they are right now, Lord God. Meet them at their point of need, Lord God. Whether it be their children, their grandchildren, their husband, their spouse, whoever. God, meet them where that need is, Lord God, and show yourself to be their banner. Show yourself to be their God. Hallelujah, Father. Thank you, Lord God. And if there's anyone over the stream, Lord God, who don't know you in the pardons of their sins, God, we pray that this word do not fall among the thorns, among the weeds, or by the wayside, but it fall on good ground, Lord God. Good ground that produce fruit in their lives, Father God. Good ground, Lord God, that brings forth salvation. Oh, Jesus, thank you, Lord God. Help them to see who you are, that you died on that cross for their sins. God, and you're coming back again, Lord God, for all those, Lord God, who have been justified by the Father. Because they believe in you. So, Lord God, I thank you. I commit them to you. And we pray in Jesus' name, Lord God, be glorified in our lives each and every day. So, So bless our pastors, Lord God. Bless Sunday, Lord God. Oh, let it be a tumultuous time, Lord God. Let your presence abide in this place, Lord God, as we celebrate. We will be here, Lord God, to celebrate. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah.